Hi, welcome to the continued discussion on the Mayor's Drug Culture Committee. We have with us tonight Susan Salamone, Jim Abadi, and Susan Batterton. All three have personal contact and consequences from this ongoing epidemic fairly recently and through a lifetime of experience. The emphasis tonight will be on parents wake up. There are no boundaries on this drug epidemic. You may be noticing more and more on the public announcements on television and discussions such as this local group that we are in a serious problem that's affecting families and particularly the young people as a whole. So without further ado, perhaps we can just start out with Susan. Why don't you give a quick background and we can go around to Jim and another Susan.
Okay, thanks for having me, Mayor. I really appreciate the opportunity to be on the show. As you know, my name is Susan Salamone. I'm the executive director of Drug Crisis in Our Backyard. And this organization was founded in 2012 after the death of my son and the co-founder's son, Carol Christensen, to a heroin overdose. So we've been running this organization for 4.5 years now, and we do many things that I'll tell you about during the course of this show. But just to give you a brief overview, my son's name was Justin, and he passed away on May 29th, 2012.
Jim?
Jimmy Abadi. I'm a lifelong resident, recovering addict. Thank you, Mayor, again, for starting this and for inviting me. We're going to talk about a lot of things. I just want to say thank you to the ladies. And recovery, we'll talk about addiction, recovery, but most all, parents be aware.
Susan.
Hi, thanks Norm for having me again, and thanks so much for starting this drug committee. I'm Susan Batterton, and I am a resident of Larchmont for over 20 years. I have a daughter in 11th grade, a daughter a sophomore in college, graduated from Amerenik High School. They've both been through the entire school system. And my stepson died of a heroin overdose November 17, 2015, at the age of 21. So I'm here to voice my concerns, my fears, and evoke as much prevention out there as possible to get parents involved to help our children and not have this continue in this epidemic.
Yeah, and along the lines that the reason this comes about, as I noted before in a previous discussion we had, I go to meetings as the mayor, New York Conference of Mayors, NICOM, and even they're aware that this is a nationwide, and particularly in New York area, it affects everybody. This is an epidemic, a severe epidemic. In fact, you know, in the village of Amerenik, we had four recent fatal ODs, probably 18 to 20 ODs, a lot of saved by Narcan and so on. In fact, unfortunately, recently in the past week, we had another fatal OD, I believe. But it's, again, it's parents wake up. It can happen to anybody. And there's all forms of addiction. What's happening when these kids are dying of the heroin because it's a cheaper version of other prescription drugs and so on that are being laced with fentanyl and now another mixed with fentanyl and rat poison and so on. But it starts also with drinking, it starts with smoking. Why we're also looking at your age, the kids that unfortunately passed on and were victims of this, we're also worried about kids in the hommocks and in the lower schools. It's going, what's your history that you found out with this group? You know, maybe you could talk about the group.
Well, I'll tell you a little bit about our story. I kind of have a long story because my son suffered with addiction for 10 years. As we know now, substance use disorder is a disease. It's a chronic progressive disease, as stated by the Surgeon General just a couple of months ago in a 400-page report. So he suffered with that disease of addiction since 19 years old. He started smoking pot at 16 years old. And as many parents out there may think, this is not, it's not a rite of passage. That's what we thought also. We go back now, my son is dead 4.5 years. And he would have been 33, so this goes back to about when he was 16. I can't even think about when he, 2000, and like 2000, right. He was 16 years old. So none of this information was out there then. So him smoking pot, we brought him to a therapist. The therapist said he would never have an addiction. Did the therapist even ask if there was addiction in the family? This is a disease that runs in families, like cancer and diabetes and high blood pressure. It is a disease that runs in families. She didn't even ask us that question. So at 19 years old, he really started getting in trouble. He was in Marist College, and between 19 and 29, he really spiraled downhill. He had multiple ODs, and the one he had in 2011 left him with a brain injury. So he was disabled. He couldn't write. He couldn't type. He couldn't play his guitar, which was really his passion. He was an excellent guitar player. And in 2012, he moved into a group home because we felt, and he felt, he was 29 years old, that he needed to be independent. And 2 weeks after moving into that group home, he OD'd and died. So we started this organization because we felt like no one was talking about this. And back in 2012, right, nobody was talking about it. And that is the truth. And we were very isolated in our suffering and in what to do about them. And we felt we were very embarrassed. And we were embarrassed to talk about it. And people are still embarrassed to talk about it. So that's why I'm so happy we are here talking about it tonight, because it's difficult to keep this conversation going, because it's not something that people will talk about on the grocery line. Like, would I say to you, my son has a problem, he shoots heroin. I mean, that would be unheard of. But I would say, my son has cancer.
Right.
And really, they're both a disease, and they need to be talked about the same way in order to take this out of the closet.
You bring up some very interesting points, several points I'm trying to remember. I guess the first question is, when did you first become aware of it? And as you said, at the time, hopefully it is changing, so it is not quote an embarrassment to talk about, and it's good. It's almost like you're talking about, what are the support groups? This is a very superficial support group. The purpose of this group and the Mayor's Drug Culture Committee is to do exactly what you talked about. Talk about it. Don't be embarrassed about it. I mean, this is a disease. But you also said something that's extremely interesting, and I think it's one of the first times I heard this, that do you think it's hereditary, aside from cultural and peer impact and so on? Because I heard in several different presentations on television and in discussions with people that are directly involved, is that the one expression, you show me your friends and I'll show you what your future is, something along those lines. So I'm just curious as how, what your recommendation is in your group. How do you tell parents what signs to look for, and how do you do it, and where do you go to help, and so on?
What do we do to,
right?
Well, we run support groups. We have four support groups around in Westchester, Putnam, and Dutchess. Actually, three right now. We had one in Westchester, but it was not faring, so we stopped it. And so we meet every week, and they're like mutual aid groups where parents could come and talk about what's happening with their children. They're sort of like Al-Anon. Like, Al-Anon is it's like like AA, but it's the opposite side of it, or NA. So AA is a support group for people that have a problem with alcohol, and there's a lot of drugs, as Jim will attest to when he tells you a little bit about that. Al-Anon is for people who are living with the alcoholic or the person who's addicted to drugs, and can't, they have a problem too, because they can't, the effects of the disease in the family are widespread. People take on roles in the family when people are suffering with this disease that are very, very distinct, roles. And I'm not going to get into that right now because it's pretty involved. We can talk about it later as the program goes on. But so we do a number of things with the families that are struggling with it. We try to direct them as to where they can get help for themselves and their kids. We have a website that has the resources for different types of treatment for outpatient or inpatient, detox, if the kids need to detox. We also have an online support group where it's a closed group. People come on and they ask, has anybody heard of this treatment center? Is it any good? And we have a list of sober homes and therapists and the whole nine yards, because we've gone through this whole thing silently with no help. So our goal is to help people who are struggling with it so that they don't have to reinvent the wheel, because the wheel is now invented, not only by us, but other people have come on board to start to come forward with information about it. But our mission originally, back 4.5 years ago, was to bring awareness of the rampant use of heroin and opiates in our community. That's our number one mission.
And what you're saying also, there's a lot of different, as we find when we speak to Jim and Susan, there are a lot of different aspects to this problem. One of the programs we're looking to do in the future, we just had Lauren Eskenazi from St. Vincent's on, and she gave a very helpful insight to actually someone who has a program, you know, a hospital program and so on. But Jim, why don't you give a viewpoint, because it's different for someone who has the history of going through something and can talk about it. Luckily, you had the wherewithal to, well, I don't know why or how to get through it.
The reason that I got involved in the first place is I believe that as a recovering addict, you're really only recovering when you can admit it and be honest about your addiction. You know, people could look down on it, you know, and I have to put that aside. If I used drugs in the past and I became an addict, there was a reason for it. It is hereditary in some instances. She was speaking basically about codependency with the family. That's what happens.
You mean with the Al-Anon?
Yeah,
that's codependency.
Right, it's codependency. We could do a whole show on that.
Right.
The main thing is that, and what I want to reach is that, I always tell people, being a recovering addict, I know the signs and the symptoms. I know what to look for because I was that person. When your kid's behavior changes, their attitudes change, you know, you have a typical 15, 16-year-old, normally the attitude changes. But when you're on drugs, you get very defensive. Denial is probably the biggest and one of the most important words. When your kid's in denial, you'll know, and they deny everything. That's a lot to do with addiction, because addiction is about behavior. And bad behavior when kids are using drugs is one of the reasons why I spoke to the high school kids, and I want to reach the parents now before the kids start using drugs. And this is, I'm going to stay on this because I think it's the most important aspect. Parents need to know what's going on in their household. You know, everybody works hard 6 days, 7 days a week, a lot of hours. A lot of times you're not paying attention because you think your kids are fine. And it's probably the number one killer is actually being blind, putting blinders on. I hate to say it. You know, most parents don't realize what's going on, and not in any fault of their own. That's why we were doing the shows, and we have this committee now, and that's why I got involved. You have to realize that any kid, doesn't matter where you come from, what race, nationality, it doesn't matter who you are, money, no money, addiction affects everyone. And the disease that it is, and we were just speaking about, is very dangerous. So, you know, when your kids are hanging out with a bad group of kids, or you don't know where they're at, you need to ask. I said this the last time, my parents in the 70s, great parents, but they had no clue about addiction. And most people didn't back in the 70s. Go ahead, you can drink, you know, have the guys over, kegs of beer, 15 years old, it's not okay. I want to tell the parents, it's not okay. My father used to say, a little pot. That drink and that little bit of pot, I ended up a full-blown heroin addict. And I'm not saying all kids, I'm not saying parents that your kid will be an addict, but you need to be aware of what they're doing, how they're acting, who they're hanging around with. You don't want to be a spy. You don't even have to spy. When your kids are doing the wrong thing, if you're keeping an eye out, you're going to know. It's very simple. You're going to know the kids are doing the wrong thing. You can't hide from addiction. You can't hide it. Your eyes, the way you look, how you take care of yourself, everything changes. Your attitude, your ambitions, everything changes. It becomes all about the drug. You live to wake up and go get drugs. The most important thing, and this is, I think we spoke about this the last time, is parents, please, you don't have to think bad, you don't have to think your kids are on drugs, but just be aware. Peer pressure, the circumstances of kids today, you know, running around, maybe your kids don't feel good about themselves. You know, I see, like, what I spoke about before. There should be recreation centers like there used to be. Kids don't have a place to go anymore. They hang out. They're doing things they shouldn't do a lot of times. You know, don't get me wrong. Not all kids. We're not talking about that. But your kid, just like myself, was an athlete. I walked the same halls like all other kids in high school. And I found the bad road. It happens. It happens all the time.
And there were many factors that bring kids to that point.
There's a million factors, but that's where I want to speak to the parents. Because if you're being aware of what's going on in your kid's life, and you're taking a look, because now the knowledge is there of addiction, and you need to take a look and say, hey, you know, maybe, like if your kids are drinking, it's not okay. Don't let it be okay that your kids are just drinking beer. Because it's not just drinking beer. That beer can lead to addiction. That beer can lead to the weed leads to the pills lead to the heroin. And before you know it, you're a full-blown addict, you're in trouble, or unfortunately, like you ladies know, and your kids are no longer here. And it's a cruel world. You're gonna have drug dealers, that's what they do. Somebody's gonna try to push it on you. You have kids that are in trouble, they don't wanna be alone. Remember, the kids that's using, they don't want to be the only one using, so they're going to try to push it on your son or your daughter. Mm-hmm. And it's a simple thing. Hey, try this, you know? People think they're escaping. Because let me tell you, when you do drugs, just like if you go to, I went to the dentist the other day, and now being in recovery, finally I got it right in my life, where I tell the dentist I'm a recovering addict, I can't take pain pills. Addicts look for every excuse to use, okay? Every excuse. And parents need to be aware of it, and that's my strongest aspect. I want to speak about that, and that's why I'm here, and that's why I volunteer.
Well, you bring 2 points that we've done before, and I hope you know you don't mind talking about it. But one, you just recently went and spoke to the kids in
Mamaroneck
School. It was interesting to note what you told me about their reactions. So it's there; they're aware of it, and they know about it. And the other aspect is you went through different stages in your life where it was very negative. And he obviously fully recovered, and I congratulate you for that, because unfortunately it doesn't happen that often. But how do you, first of all, where's your mindset to get into it, or is it just slowly? And even more important, how do you get out of it? I mean, it's like, you know, you should stop smoking. It's not good for your health. But people are going to have to be hypnotized. They have to take that. How do you get to the point, and this is the most important part, how do you get to the kids to say, this is how you do it?
Yeah.
Well, for me, when I spoke to the kids, I spoke about smart choices. And, you know, this is my thing. You want to try to reach kids before they're using. You want to try to reach them where they're hanging around. They may be going down that avenue. They're not there yet. Those are the kids you want to speak to them about making smart choices. You know, even there was an officer a couple weeks ago, bad choice. Drinking, got in his car, got in an accident, killed his friend. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter. You know, people make bad choices behind alcohol, behind marijuana, behind everything. You want to talk to kids to make smart choices. Getting into it gradually, it's really behavior, I have to tell you. You know, I started out as a young kid, and you start little things that are bad, and you know they're bad. It could be anything. You know, your parents are not watching, so you're getting away with little things. Before you know it, you're hanging around with the guy that's a little older than you, and he's doing bad things. That's what leads you. You get into a circle of negativity. And drugs, unfortunately, this is what happens. The negativity is drugs. It is alcohol. You know, and you're in a circle where kids are using. And when you get in that circle, it gets so deep sometimes, and you can't pull out. The reason I was fortunate enough to pull out, it took me a long time. And it's all about consequences, all about consequences. And that's the other thing. Let your kids have consequences. When they're doing bad things, don't say, hey, it's okay. There's got to be a consequence. Because if there's no consequences, no action, then it's okay to do it. You know? And it doesn't mean anything. If they're going to school and they're starting to do bad in school, let there be a consequence. Whatever it may be, take something away, whatever you have to do. If you just let it go, you're starting a fire. You're starting with the match. You're starting the fire, and as long as kids, you know, kids will do it. If they know they can get away with something, they push the envelope. All people do that. And as a child, and then, you know, you start doing that and your behaviors get worse and worse. And if you're using, that gets worse and worse. And your addiction gets worse and worse. Doesn't get any better. And the main thing I know is that the drugs and the alcohol will win that battle in your life every time. Unless you finally had enough, which happened to me. And unfortunately, most kids don't get to that point. So we need to get them before they get 3 stages of addiction. You want to get them before they hit even the first stage, if you can. That's who we want to reach. And you want to reach the parents.
Yeah, it's an excellent segue. Susan, fortunately for your 2 daughters, I think you have a lot to for the impact that they had. But it's interesting because they are just as involved, even though they're fairly young compared to us and their brother and so on. It was interesting to note that at the meetings, they came out, if you really want to know the truth, what's going on, parents, listen. Ask your kids. Hopefully they'll communicate with you and tell you. But sit there and like little Lord Fauntleroy, I'm sitting listening to these kids saying they have a Skittles party. Mm-hmm. A Skittles party is when the kids have a party and they go into the
parents' medicine cabinets.
Right, the medicine cabinets. They'll take out pills. They don't even know what they are. They throw them into a bowl. Yep. And the kids pick out pills. They don't know what it is. They don't have that. They pop the pill. They take a drink and so on. Or like your daughter described one time, driving by and finding a young girl out totally drunk. Could be actually dying from swallowing on her own throat and so on. Bring the kids home. And what's the attitude of the parents? Not too good. So, I mean, that's the segue.
Care.
You know, once you talk about your unfortunate experience and how it is and how at least, how do you get your kids to be so cognizant of it and being self-survival, to be surrounded, because you're surrounded by the peer pressure, it's unbelievable. I don't think there's a kid in a high school anywhere in the United States that doesn't know if they want or they can buy drugs in school.
This is true, very, very true. What would you like me to talk about first? Because you're asking me something.
Right. Why don't you talk about your experience and how you get into it? Again, with the central theme, parents wake up. You know, this is what it is. You went through a personal experience like many people. It's certainly not to be embarrassed talking about it because it's realistic. And the more we talk about it, perhaps you'll save someone else's life. That's the whole idea of the show, is to communicate. And you went through a terrible experience, but yet you've turned it into a positive thing by getting involved. I mean,
I'll tell you, to bounce off of what Susan said also and Jimmy, is that one of the things that when you talked about not talking about it in 2012, people don't realize when they are on a line at the supermarket or they're sitting next to someone in the office and they say, my son died, there's not one person out there that hasn't known someone, doesn't have a family member, a child, an experience with drug addiction, alcoholism, heroin overdose, whatever. I mean, it's just, and that's a comforting thing to be able to know that you can talk about it, like Susan's saying, because it's been a hush-hush thing, especially heroin. So, you know, the more people know that they have an outlet, like with us, and going to this town hall committee that I'm going to talk about, you know, and have an outlet and a place to go to, like the website, and to find people, like Jimmy goes to see this kids in the schools, and they feel like, wow, I know that the feedback on it has been amazing. The kids are like so excited to meet someone who's actually been through it, like, wow, we can actually find someone to talk to feel safe. It is a hush-hush thing, especially heroin still. But now you don't have to shoot it anymore. Shooting was the big, thing that deterred people in the 80s and 90s. Now you snort it, now you smoke it, now you do everything with it, and it's cheaper than buying a Percocet. I mean, I could talk to you about so many things. The kids just went through midterms, and the kids are trying to buy Adderall and medicine off of each other to get through midterms. I mean, just my kids have been exposed to so much stuff in the high school and middle school. Danielle, my 11th grader, talks about the other day about pot or weed or whatever you want to call it nowadays, that it's a gateway drug. That's the term that's used. So you start that in like 6th grade, let's say, 7th, maybe even earlier in elementary school. And by the time you're in 9th grade, you're drinking and smoking more weed. And then by the time you're in 11th grade, they're snorting cocaine. And then by the time they're out of high school, they need more of a high. So that's when they turn to heroin. And heroin is so horribly accessible. It's as accessible as getting an opioid, a painkiller. And it's laced. Like now, in like the 80s and 70s and 90s, when we all partied and stuff, it was horrible, okay? But it wasn't laced. Now you don't even know what you're getting. And that's what's so scary. And we can't get these people off the streets that are selling to our kids. But it's all over. I mean, Mamaroneck is and Larchmont are just prevalent with drugs and alcohol. And it's something that the parents are, in my opinion, being with parents for the last 20 some odd years, are so oblivious to what's going on. I'm probably the only parent that has never condoned drinking in my household. My kids used to say, "Mom, you're the worst mom. You're like, you're so uncool. So-and-so, who's, you know, religious and everything. Why can their parents give them parties?" I've never done. Now my girls understand. You know, they really get it. Like, why I'm actually the coolest mom. Because I actually cared and care and never wanted to lead them in the wrong way. I take the pills out of my cabinets. All these parents have condoned drinking. They leave their medicine in their cabinets. I know they do because I've been to their houses. My kids tell me. And the kids go into the cabinets and take medicine. And the other thing the parents don't realize is that they're role models. So they're telling their kids it's okay to drink. They're telling their kids, I take a pill because I'm anxious. I take a pill because I'm in pain. They're models for, well, I'm going to take a Xanax because I'm stressed out from work today. They come home right away and they take a drink. Like, those are the solutions instead of dealing with the problems, instead of communicating about them. One of the things you asked me about my girls is I have an incredible relationship with my daughters. And our communication lines have been open forever. I've been educating them. Their father's in recovery, you know, so I've been educating them forever. They've been exposed to meetings, you know, Al-Anon meetings or whatever that they've gone to learn. And it's given them a step up. Now, listen, they're predisposed, as you talk about with hereditary, they're predisposed. So, of course, am I worried? Yes. Have they tried to experiment? Yes. Are they normal? Yes. But all that stuff leads to very dangerous, risky behaviors, as Jimmy talks about behaviors. And what parents don't realize is when your child is tired, when your child's like not feeling a part of, when your child's anxious, when your child is stressed, when your child is tired all the time or not doing that, and their behaviors start changing, they need to like clue in. And a lot of these children that are having heroin overdoses, parents are clueless. And at this town hall meeting, there's gonna be a parent speaking who lost their child, who absolutely was clueless. I mean, you know, not her being clueless and stuff, but wasn't aware of the signs. So can I share this with
you? Yeah, absolutely. So, and while you're doing, before, for those at home, you can call in with comments and questions. It's 914-381-0150. 381-0150. I'm sorry, Susan, go ahead.
No, fine. I hope people call in with questions. Our community, the town of Larchmont and Mamaroneck, we are having a town hall meeting in response to the opioid epidemic. It's called You Can't Stop What You Don't Know, Your Child, Drugs, and Our Community. Drugging is happening in our community. It's not a rite of passage, and there is something we can do about it. It's going to be on May 9th at 7:30 at the Mamaroneck High School, and the location in the high schools it will be determined soon. Please help us by contributing to support this event. We're looking for sponsorship or donations to help fund this town hall meeting. If you'd like more information, you can call me directly at 914-826-5266, and I'll be happy to help you with anything you need. And if you want to write a check, you can write a check right now and send it to, payable to the Larchmont Mamaroneck RADAR. And RADAR stands for Responsible Action, a Drug and Alcohol resource. This check will be tax deductible, or it's a 501c3. The town hall meeting is being coordinated by Mayor Norm Rosenblum and the Village of Mamaroneck Drug Culture Committee, RADAR, the Larchmont League of Women Voters, and the Larchmont Mamaroneck Summit. Please mark your calendars, save the date, and bring all your questions.
If you do write a check, on the memo, make sure it's specifically to support that program.
Right. It's Larchmont Mamaroneck /RADAR, R-A-D-A-R. And I'll just tell you what it's going to be. So the evening is going to include a parent's story from a drug crisis in our backyard. A keynote speaker is going to be there, Mike Nerney. He's a national parenting expert with 30 years of expertise and also the former director of the National Drug Research Institute. This evening is guaranteed to provide insight and practical skills to help support your teenager. This evening will enlighten, educate, and armor you with the 21st century solutions, helping you navigate the scary, potentially deadly world of drugs. Please don't miss this opportunity to become a more informed parent.
You know, one of the programs you talked about and the effect that you have, tough love, or whatever way I would describe it, I remember one of the first communications I had with your daughters were not actually their brother, which is interesting. My question is, what was the impact then? Because I'm sure their awareness of the problem wasn't as great when that happened as it is now. But there was a young kid who OD'd, not purposely, but it was for, I forgot what it was, you know, and they wanted to name the basketball court after them, stuff like that. The real question is,
you're talking about
Brandon
Wesley.
Right. Yeah. What impact does that have if the kids forget about it? In other words, your daughters have a direct impact, so it's going to affect them more. But you had a whole series. I can tell you, I must have got from kids probably 30 or 50 communications. Oh, let's name the program. Let's rename the park. But what happens afterwards? Do they forget it, or do they really remember? How do you get, like I asked Jimmy before, how do you get these kids to continue to realize, like, hey, you know, if I keep smoking, I'm going to die of cancer. If I keep taking drugs, there's a good shot I'm going to OD. Or is it the fact that nothing's ever going to happen to me? I'm too young.
Yes, that
I'm infallible.
It is. They do think they're invincible. Yes.
All kids think that. But that's why it's very important what we're doing now, your group, our group, very important. It's very important that we get the parents involved. Because that's you need to speak to the kids. I spoke at the high school. I didn't think I honestly did. I went there. I said these kids are going to listen to me, and I had a good impact. They listened. They gave a lot of feedback. They asked a lot of questions. You know, kids are at the unknown. They think that they're going to live forever. We all
right.
did, you know. And they're going out into the unknown, just like I did. You know, how do you grow up? Everything is trial and error in life, and that's just what it is. So if you give some insight, for me, and I want to speak to anybody, if you're a recovering addict and you're truly clean and you're living a decent life, because I'm not the only one, get involved. Come out, get involved. Come to Mamaroneck, come to our meetings and get involved. You know what? I'm very fortunate to be here today. I am blessed. I am blessed to have my family, my business. At one point, I had nothing. Okay, and I'm lucky to be alive, and I want to speak to anyone that's in recovery. It doesn't matter if it's drugs, alcohol. If you're truly in recovery and you are clean and you're doing the right thing, get involved, please. That's what the kids need. They don't need us to speak and be insincere. They need sincere people that have been through it, that are doing. Because you know what? I feel like I can be a role model, okay? I'm not just saying it. I'm living my life clean. And I think I said last time, I always thought I needed a drink or a drug to communicate, to be able to hang out and deal with people. But you know what? You don't. You learn you don't need that. It's nothing but destruction. Nothing but destruction. I want the kids to understand that. When I went to the high school and I spoke about smart choices, and I told them, listen, you're not going to get anything from alcohol. You're not going to get anything from pot or any other drug you do except destruction. I don't care who you are.
What kids need to learn and understand, and parents need to understand, is experimenting is normal, but it's not okay.
It's not necessary.
It's just not okay. It's just parents don't realize, kids don't realize that what that leads to. Right. And if parents are better communicators, and if parents actually showed that they cared, like we care, like by putting boundaries and restrictions in their lives, like you need to be home at a certain time. Like so many of my daughter's friends don't have any curfews. Okay, I'm not telling parents how to parent, but in other words, my daughters, I say to them, like, would you rather me not want to know where you are? Would you rather me not care? And their answer is, no, I want you to care, you know, because parents don't know where their children are. They don't know when they're coming home. They go to sleep. The kids come in wasted or whatever, and they don't have any idea what the patterns are, who their kids are hanging out with. I want to know who my children are hanging out with. I want to meet them. You know, they get it. Yeah, it's annoying. Do they like it? No. But do I do it? Yes, because I want to know that they're safe. And I want to know, like you started this out with, like, you know, you are who you hang out with. And if you're hanging around, it's like people, places, and things. And Jimmy will speak of this. When you're in recovery, if you change, if you don't change the people you're hanging out with, the places that you go, and the people, and the things that you do, in other words, going to bars or going to the parties or hanging out with the kids that don't study or you know, having another drink, whatever it might be. If you don't change those patterns, and those behaviors will never change. And parents need to realize that if your kids are trying to separate from that, that to encourage them, you know, if they're like, I don't feel a part of anymore because I'm doing this, but, you know, to support them in that, you know, that to try to make changes. Change is scary. Change is not a comfortable thing to do. But if you see that your children are hanging out with the wrong kind of kids, and you see that your child's behavior is changing, you see them going to places that they shouldn't be going, certain parties where they're you know, my kids will talk about that they go to parties that are called ragers. I can't tell you how many families, parties, parents home, usually not for a rager. A rager means like it's a big, big party and it gets blown up by the police. But often there's parties where the parents are home.
Yeah.
11th grade, 10th grade.
We're experiencing the same thing in Putnam. I'm from Putnam County, and we basically do a lot of work in Putnam and Southern Dutchess and Northern Westchester. And I think this is like really a cultural shift that has to happen in order for us to get our arms around this epidemic, which it definitely is. I mean, Governor Cuomo had a heroin task force. Mm-hmm. Last May. I was on it, actually. And we went around to 8 communities and talked about the problem in the communities, 8 communities throughout New York State. And people came and spoke about how dreadful it is. And so it's really, this is something that has been identified as a very serious issue for a number of reasons. And in order for us to get our arms around it, it has to be a cultural change. Someone spoke about smoking before, and they were able to make this cultural change with smoking.
Right.
I mean, when you think back in the 50s, everybody was smoking. I used to smoke.
Smoked.
Everybody
drinking.
Smoked.
But we didn't know the
dangers.
It was
part of the cultures
then.
And
yes,
movies and everything else.
Exactly right. But we
but
do
now
know,
we
the
know the dangers.
But you know what? We know the dangers because of the PSAs and the commercials and the research that was put behind that industry. And the tobacco industry paid millions of dollars in payments to people that lost their lives.
And they also pay with the PSAs for that now.
Exactly. And you know what? That's what has to happen now. The drug companies have to be brought to task for starting this epidemic, because quite frankly, between 1996 and 2001, Purdue Pharma, who is a Stanford-based company that patented OxyContin, spent $135 million marketing this as a non-addictive drug to doctors, okay? At non-addictive drugs. In 2007, they were sued for $634 million they paid and pleaded guilty to false advertising. Well, thank you. It was already flooded the streets, and the kids had started with OxyContin.
I believe it. I brought it up at a previous meeting.
And
I had a physical procedure. It was a quick operation, gallbladder, as a matter of fact. Now it's nothing. But they gave me a prescription. I went to fill it. I had no idea what it was. I looked at it. It was prescription for 50 OxyContin, only because I was aware of OxyContin. I didn't take one pill. Because it's so extreme and so addictive right away.
So addictive.
Yeah, now they give it to kids like it's a pill.
Now there's some legislation around that was just passed into law on June 22nd by Governor Cuomo.
Let me just say something about that. The doctors are full of it. I'm going to say it just like that, because not for nothing. They know it's an opiate. An opiate is addictive. It doesn't matter if it's OxyContin, if it's any other morphine, anything based opiate is addicting. So the doctors that went to school and they know everything about it, that's their way of going around it. They were handing these scripts out knowing they were addictive. They can say what they want. It's a lie. Because any doctor that went to college for all those years and got their degree know that any opiate based is addicting. So when they did that, that was their way, and they were handing them out. You can blame the company that made them, just like you're not going to stop the drug dealers. They're legitimate drug dealers. You're never going to stop it in the street, and you're not going to stop it legally. okay? But the difference is it rolls down to here you get it. They make it, the doctor pushes it, okay? They pushed it on to they know it was addicting. You give out a script. I go to the dentist, right, back in the day, they go, here, you need a script? You need pain pills? Yeah, okay. Me being an addict, I was like, yes, I definitely, you know, because an addict's not going to be honest. He's going to, yeah, that's his out. So when they say the doctors didn't know, it's all business. That was a crock. So any opiate-based anything is addicting. If yeah. you take it, if you take it, just like if you're supposed to take one pill every 8 hours and you start taking two, 3 days, you're hooked.
You're hooked.
3 days.
My parents, this is like so important, is that parents need to realize it can happen to their child. Mm-hmm. I can't tell you, it's large from Mamaroneck, I can speak for because I live here, but I can tell you that it's prevalent all over the country. No one thinks it's gonna happen to you. No one, whether it's alcoholism, drug addiction, heroin addiction, It's scaffolding. You know, it starts with the weed, and then it goes to the yep. drinking, and then it goes to the, you know, cocaine, and then, you just need a higher. And anyone can have an addiction. Some people are predisposed because of the hereditary, they have family in recovery, or if they're blessed to be in recovery, or there has been alcoholism or drug addiction in their family, it's definitely hereditary. But there are plenty of people, you get hooked on drugs, like the co-founder of Drug Crisis in Her Backyard. Her son was a detective, I think, right?
He was a narcotics detective.
Yeah.
He was 28 years old when he passed, Eric Christensen.
Right.
And
he was never into drugs, and he got medicine for back surgery.
Right, for back pain. I don't even know if he had surgery.
Yeah.
And when we first met, they brought over the bottles of that had been prescribed to him, and they were just like so many pills a month were being prescribed to this.
Doctors.
And it keeps going. They
have the doctors are the legal drug dealers, and that's what I said. That's why I said that. Their knowledge, just like we want to make the parents have knowledge of addiction and bad behaviors, their knowledge, and they're cracking down on it, but their knowledge of addiction and substance abuse is far greater than that people give them credit for. They know. They didn't care. Okay, I believe everything is a business, unfortunately. The doctors give you the pills and they don't follow up. Well, you know, you got to take it this way. It's not their job to say.
They don't even tell you how or when.
Well, they may tell you on it, but they need to also say, you know, that on the bottles that how addicting they are. They need to put labels on it. Right. They don't. There's no labels.
I think they might be now.
Well, my OxyContin, it was fairly recently. Doesn't say a word.
No,
on
it doesn't say
it. Just
how
take it as needed.
Right. This is what I'm trying to say. When you just hand somebody, when you hand someone a medication, just as what we're speaking about, parents and giving them knowledge to take an eye and keep an eye on their kids. When a doctor hands you a medication that knows is very addicting, okay, anybody can get addicted. Anyone. And they just hand you and say, take one every 5 hours as needed or whatever it may be. There should be a label on there that this drug can be very addicting. People need to know.
Right.
Not everybody
like
knows.
Like the environmental.
Like
right, that is dangerous.
Like the environmental warnings and the symbols, for chemicals.
Right.
They have it in the skull and crossbones. They should have that
right.
on the pills.
If I could go behind that person and say, you know what, here's where you're going to end up, guys. Okay, that's the difference.
I'd like to say something to the parents about when they have their kids' wisdom teeth pulled.
I was just going to tell you, my daughter had a wisdom teeth
pulled. Well, the doctors are going to give my son, they gave my son, I have four boys, actually. I lost my first one, so I have three boys that are still alive. Justin was my oldest. My youngest is Dylan. He graduated from BC, and he had four wisdom teeth pulled before he went to do some work in South America. And they gave him 30 Percocet. And I didn't give them to him, needless to say.
Because you're aware of it.
Because I'm aware of it. But the doctor won't let you leave the office without giving you the prescription. I've had parents who have told their doctors, I'm not taking that prescription home. And the doctor gives them the prescription anyway.
I'm going to piggyback
on that. They make money on that.
I'm going to piggyback on that for a second. I just went to the dentist 3 days ago, and now I'm a recovering addict, and I tell them I don't take anything. They yanked my tooth out because I had to put a post in. They yanked it out. I mean, it took them an hour to get this tooth out. Motrin. They don't have to give you a narcotic. They gave me 800 milligrams of Motrin, an antibiotic. Okay? pain, you can get over pain, okay? It'll take a couple of days. Addiction takes a lot longer than that. So at the end of the day, you can tell your doctor, I don't want narcotics. They don't have to give you narcotics. They'll give you extra strength, Motrin. And then you have to tell your kids, listen, it's going to be a little painful, but you're going to live. You're
going to
be okay. But if you get caught, you get strung out on those pills, you may not live.
You know what people don't, what parents need to understand is addiction is a lifetime.
Yeah.
So it's not 3 days of Motrin. Alcoholism is a family disease. Addiction is a family disease. It affects everyone in the family, as you said, in different ways. And it's very hard and difficult for anyone involved in the family. I mean, you know, and so when a child gets addicted, you know, takes these medicines, it can lead to addiction. It's just as simple as that. And it's a statistic and it's a fact. And parents take medicine all the time for pain, and they take it for stress. And the parents say, my daughter's stressed out. They send them to the guidance counselor. I've said this before, at the high school. The high school calls the parents and says, your daughter is, you know, anxious. Maybe she needs a therapist. They go to the therapist. The therapist prescribes Xanax or you know, Valium, it used to be.
All the answers Xanax. Is a pill. Take a pill.
And then they start taking pills. And then they start selling them at school. And, or you know, and Xanax is an easy drug that people are overdosing on, too, because... Yeah. Xanax, you take it and you kind of chill out, you know, you're mellow, and then all of a sudden you don't realize if you took it, you know, so you take another one.
You black out.
And they drink.
And then drinking at the same time, is it?
Along the lines of before. Black out like alcohol. So
because I want to go back to the point you made. It's great to be friendly with your kids, but you shouldn't be their friend, you should be their parent. Right. And going back to what you both said.
Be a parent, not a friend.
That's correct. So on one level, when you bring the kids to the doctors, be aware of the drugs. They shouldn't even take them and so on. But I want to get back to the point that just came up with your daughters when they mentioned it, about these parties. I mean, how do you change what you talked about before, where you change the culture? The same way when you change it from smoking cigarettes and drinking alcohol, like it used to be cute. It was in the movies, every movie. You used to be able to smoke in school.
Right.
You can't do it now. How do you change what's going on now with the parents? Even though they're home, they're saying, well, it's okay. But not only are you endangering their kids, they're endangering every other kid that comes there. How do we do it? And by the way, this group is expanding so much that this cultural group now has members from the judicial, has members from the district attorney's office, and so on. How do we make an impact on parents that are now listening, which the central theme is, wake up, parents. You're going to kill your kids unless you're smart, basically. Not intentionally, but be smart. It can happen to you. Be prepared ahead of time. Don't cry afterwards.
Right. That's exactly right. That's how you do it. By saying that over and over again. By saying that this can be happening in your house.
They have to start setting examples for their children. They have to start getting all their drugs and alcohol out of the house. You know, not to say they can't have a bottle of wine in the house or drink, you know, and enjoy themselves. I'm not telling parents not drink or whatever, but to not set examples for them. Like, this is, I'm stressed out and I'm going to have a drink over this instead of talking about it or saying I'm going to go see a therapist or whatever it might be. But mostly it's just, you know, taking medicine and exposing them to things that, or making things accessible to them. Like the alcohol and pills in the household.
I'd like to just say one thing about alcohol. Can we just say something that alcohol is a drug?
It is.
So when I talk about drug addiction, I'm including alcohol in that.
I do too.
I know they separate alcoholism from drug addiction.
No.
But there is no difference.
It's the gateway. You talk about pot. It's alcohol is more of the gateway than pot is.
Right. Yeah. Pot's a gateway to alcohol, and alcohol is a gateway to everything else.
With the alcohol and with the parents, what I'm going to say. There's a reason why it's illegal to drink at a certain age.
Right.
There's reasons for everything. Because adults are more responsible or supposed to be. Okay? And so to let your kids drink underage, you're setting them up for failure.
Yeah.
Whether you want to look at it or not. You may think it's just a drink, but that drink leads to other things. So there's a reason why it's illegal until, what is it, 18 now? Or is
21.
It over 21.
21.
21, which is 21. Great. Because here's what happens with drugs, alcohol. When you start using, if you start using at 15 and you start using drugs, your mental and your growth process stops at that age.
It's called arrested development.
Okay, and I know for a fact, okay? So that's what you're doing to your kid. You're stopping their development, their brain development, their social skills, everything. If your kids think they need a drink or they need to smoke pot or they got to do a pill to socialize, That's what happens. These kids, they don't feel like they can go out and socialize
or
without
to cope with stress
or with anything. But you know,
or anxiety, whatever.
I'd like to add on to what you said, Jimmy, because not only do they, it's more than the arrested development, and you'll hear this from Mike Nerney, that an adolescent brain is 7 to 15 times more likely to get addicted to a substance than an adult brain. So the longer we could keep this at bay with our kids, the better chance they're going to have of making it through without getting addicted to a substance.
And that was my point exactly, because here's the difference. An adult, if they may use a pill, they realize they're using it for that purpose. And the kids using it, they're using it when they go to get high, when they drink, they're drinking, they're getting high. They feel, ooh, this is great. They don't know all the consequences and the outcome. Where an adult, at a certain point in life, you've seen it a lot more, you know a lot more, okay? Parents forget that, and they put it on the back burner when their kids are partying. You know, just because, like my father, he hardly ever drank, okay? But when he drank, they went out and they had a good time. Kids, they drink, and then they drink some more. And they drink some more. They don't even know what they're doing. Kids don't have the responsibility that adults have.
They don't have the brain. Well, the brain is still developing.
That's my point. But you stop it here. So when these parents say it's okay to drink or a little pot, you only smoked a little. No, you're wrong. Because they're 15 years old. You just stopped their development. That's what you're doing.
Well, it's interesting you talk about age, because we've discussed this before. You know, you're talking about kids that are in the beginning of getting hooked and so on. How do you get to the kids? It's just as important. That would be, in essence, in the homics before that. And it is getting younger and younger. How do you get to them? Like, does your program also address those kids aside from the young adults?
We really work more with parents that are struggling with this. We are an organization that brings awareness, and we work, I told you, support groups. We do early intervention with kids that have gotten, young kids that have just gotten caught smoking pot mm-hmm. or drinking with their parents, so we have a program around that. We also go to the jails. We go to Putnam Jail, and we work with the inmates there once a week. So our program is more for adults and young adults that are currently involved with addiction, whereas Jimmy's talking about doing more prevention, and there's a lot of prevention organizations around. NCADD in Westchester is a prevention organization. They're OASIS certified, and they are about prevention. So, whereas we do talk to the kids, we go out and talk, we tell our personal story, what happened to us. They really like that. They like to hear the personal stories, as Jimmy said. And but what I say to parents is, model the behavior you want to see your kids have and get that medication out of your cabinets. There are plenty of places you can drop medications now.
They have that now. You can drop it off at the police stations.
Yeah, Larchmont.
Any time of the year you can do it, but there's special days during the year that you can drop it off through, I think, the Village of Amerenik.
It's
Town of Amerenik.
Amerenik doesn't have it. We're looking to institute it. But right now you can go to the Larchmont PD and drop the
it's
drugs
also
off.
The Town of Amerenik.
I don't know if the town
village.
Has it. I know Larchmont does, but you can always call up and
but
find
they have
out.
Drop boxes, and they collected, like, I don't know, what did they say they collected? You know, hundreds and thousands of pills in October.
That, from the parents. But the kids, listen, at the end of the day, you can drop all the pills in there you want as parents. When the kids are already starting to use, they're going to find them somewhere. It's get them out of the house, definitely. But
if a person wants a drug or alcohol, they're going to find it. An addict is going to find it.
Well, we don't want that.
That's what you don't want.
Yeah, the addict part, I want to take that out of the equation for a minute. What I spoke about at the high school, there should be more programs. There should be more people like myself going into the schools. And they should make it, I know we said it before, and I said it, English, math, science, those are really important. Obviously, you want to go to college, you want to better your life. But you want social skills, and you want kids to know making smart choices, and you want kids to know about addiction before they start to use, before they start to. You got the kids
so
that were in
if we can educate the parents can educate the child.
Yeah, but not, and I don't disagree with you. The parents, very important, but 100%, your kids, 100%, when they listen to their parents, they don't always listen to their parents. You want people that have been there, done it. You want to try to get recovering addicts, and because we're not, you know, it's not that many. Like, there's a lot of people that have been recovered. There are a lot of people.
23 million.
Right. So if you can get someone else to reach out to these kids and start programs out there, if you talk about how we're going to help these kids, that's how you're going to help them. Show them the real deal from real people, not statistics, not because they're not going to listen to that.
I can tell you right now. A younger person, high school kids talking to the fifth graders. I was supposed to go in and talk to DARE, the DARE program in fifth grade, Mamaroneck Academy School, and talk with the parents and the children, and it's still being scheduled. And if you can get them young and the parents and the children together, is even better.
Right.
If you can talk to both of them. But Jimmy's right. I mean, I have people I know that are in recovery as well that are, say, a 22-year-old that's a girl, so it's, you know, different gender, going in and talking because it's who they relate to. And if you catch one person and save one life,
it's worth it.
It's worth it.
Along those lines, believe it or not, the hour is just on this up.
Okay.
We will continue this conversation. Please take the last couple of minutes and how to contact you. Again, the strength of your program. Reiterate what the May program is going to be and how to contact. And also, you can send me an email at nrosenblum@vomny.org. Any along those lines.
All right, our website is drugcrisisinourbackyard.org. We are a 501c3 organization, community action group. We have a location at 16 Fair Street in Carmel, and our phone number is 845-842-1212. We are having a forum in Northern Yorktown with Senator Terrence Murphy on April 6th about the impact of addiction on youth, family, and community.
Larchmont Mamaroneck community is having a town hall meeting on May 9th at 7:30 p.m. at the Mamaroneck High School. It's called You Can't Stop What You Don't Know, Your Child, Drugs, and Our Community. And it's going to be something that we're looking for sponsorship. We're also looking for any contributions to help fund this event. My number is 914-826-5266. You can call me for any information you'd like to, you can donate money. To write a check to Larchmont Mamaroneck Radar, RADAR, and you can also, I guess that's the best thing to do is do that, and please come. It's tax deductible, 501c3.
I want to say one more thing before we go. Anyone that's watching this program, pass it on. If you're watching the program, pass it on to the parents. Please get involved. It's very important. Anyone that you know may be interested, get them involved. Any help that we can give for our kids is 100% going to help someone. If we get one kid not to use drugs or to clean their act up, whatever it may be, please get involved. That's why we're here. That's why everyone's doing this. We want involvement. Thank you.
Susan, and Jim, thank you very much. We'll wrap this up by saying the next tentatively scheduled date for the Mayor's Drug Culture Committee will be February 23rd in the courtroom in the Village of Mamaroneck. I'd like to thank LMC TV to make this thing available. And the bottom line is, parents out there, please wake up. Love your kids and save your kids and save your kids' friends. So we thank you very much.
Thanks, Norm.
Thank you again.
Thank you, Norm.
Thank you.